to this man. He is on a mission to change the way we take care of ourselves and each other.
We're ready for some significant change, you know, but people haven't been able to make that change. For the last 8 years, we've been forced to buy health insurance from a small number of companies. 86% of costs in America, of healthcare costs, are actually driven by chronic disease. And we have a doctor network doing functional medicine and integrative medicine that is capable of reversing these diseases, getting people off drugs and keeping people well. That has to be the foundation for a future of healthcare, no matter who's paying. And we are starting the first non-denominational health cost sharing community to help people take care of each other and take care of themselves in a much more efficient way.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life.
Thank you so much for being here this evening. Very proud in beyond. We are not only here in the OC tonight, we are streaming live to people all over the internet who want to know about the new vision. First of all, thank you so much for coming out. I know it's an unbelievably hot summer evening. There's many things you could be doing. And just to take a moment for whatever set of circumstances happened by which led you to this moment right here. There was some sort of combination of those things. Just to take a moment to say thank you and to appreciate those people who introduced you, because I hope tonight what you'll see is something that is going to inform you, but also hopefully inspire you to, you know, to want to be part of something that could be really transformative to healthcare. If you're here tonight, if you've taken the time to come to sort of like a weird health thing in OC Plaza, then I think that maybe you are ready for some significant change. You don't like the way the healthcare system is set up right now. And what I hope to show you tonight is that there is not only hope, but there is action that we can take as a community to facilitate that transformation, not like in 5 years or 10 years or in the next presidency, but this year. So, here we go. So these are the sponsors for tonight's show, and rather than just sort of talk about them now, I'm going to put them all into context, because one of the cool things about making your own show and cruising around the country in a bus and, you know, coming up with this stuff is you get to choose whoever you want. And hopefully you saw outside, you know, we've chosen companies to partner with who help us fulfill the mission. And the mission, you know, up until about 5 years ago, I would characterize myself as sort of like an activist guy. Can anyone else feel like they're kind of like an activist in a certain way? I was angry. I would go on marches. I would sort of turn up at things where other people were angry. And ultimately what I realized is that, you know, 5 years ago, I was just sort of sitting there and I came across this quote from Bucky Fuller. And this has been on the bottom of my email. If you've received an email from me in the last 5 years, you would have seen this quote. He says, "You never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete." If you're in healthcare and you read that, you can't go back. And the reason why is because there's so clearly a new model that would make the existing model obsolete, and that's by keeping people healthy. And that's what we're going to talk about today in many different ways. So the show itself, as a spoiler alert, is that we've essentially set up the event tonight is going to sort of seek to sort of answer this question, which is, how would we build this new model, right? How would we build the new model? And what you're going to hear is from myself and some of the incredible speakers that we have here tonight, ways in which we think it makes sense to build the new model and how we're going to build it. So let's just jump into it. Chapter one. So how would we build the new model if we knew community was the most powerful force in health creation? So, you know, this is an article from The Guardian. It says, this is about a place called Froome in Somerset, which is near where my mum lives in England, near where I grew up. They say, the town has found a potent cure for illness, community. Freeman Somerset has seen a dramatic fall in emergency hospital admissions since it began a collective project to combat isolation, right? I think everyone is aware that, and if you're not, that isolation is one of the biggest risk factors for chronic disease. And so if we knew that healthcare, if you knew the community was the strongest force in health creation, what would we do? We build communities. We put on events at the OC Plaza, and we'd invite people, and we connect. Like, that's what we would start to do, and that's what we've done here at the Functional Forum. Now, just as I start this process, this comes out in the New York Times. Last week, it was the number one most shared episode on the New York Times, and they talked about in Okinawa, Japan, which is a blue zone. Who's familiar with the blue zone research, right? The healthiest places in the world, where people live to 100. People form a kind of social network called a MOAI, a group of five friends who offer social, logistical, emotional, even financial support for a lifetime. So this is in the like culture of the world right now, right? This is the most important conversation happening in healthcare. And so, you know, as I said before, community is the guru of the future. That's what Thich Nhat Hanh says that, and that's been a part. So we're gonna take some action, right? You're gonna sit, I know these chairs are unbelievably comfortable, and you're welcome. But first and foremost, like, what I want to do is just a little exercise. So we found so far that, like, you've decided, for whatever reason you guys have decided to be here, right? There's a very unique set of circumstances that have caused you to be here, but there are other people here too. And so what we're going to do is we're going to take 60, maybe 90 seconds, depending on how much fun you're having. And your goal is to find someone that you've never met before. I want you to tell them each other your names and tell them why you're here. You've got 60, 90 seconds. Go get it.
Hi.
Sam. Sunshine.
Hi, Sam. I'm Claudia.
Hey, Claudia.
Okay, why are you here? Are you in
service? I'm a primary care doctor.
Oh, you are?
Locally, yeah. So I've been kind
like
of following.
Like an MD doctor?
Yeah. I know, I'm kind of crazy.
Okay, go ahead, talk, because now I'm interested.
I know, so I go to all the functional forum stuff, you know, and it's in Irvine.
Okay.
Are you familiar with that?
No, I go to the chiropractor stuff. That's why I was like, okay. Because that's why I was like, oh my gosh, okay.
Yeah, I don't think there's many here. Dr. Birch at the end, she's really speaking. She's a gynecologist.
Actually, she was my gynecologist when her partner delivered my son.
Oh my god.
Yes. Oh yeah, so trust me, I know.
So she's an MD.
So
she's
been around for 20 some years.
She's kind of my role model. So yeah, I've been in practice for 20 years.
Okay.
I would love someday to try to learn all this stuff, but it's voluminous.
Okay, first of all, they don't teach that in medical school. You're lucky if you get a bedside manner in medical school. All you get is anatomy, physiology, blah, 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 and then whatever your specialty is. My brother was an oral surgeon, so I know all about that.
Anyway. What do you do? Are you a chiropractor?
No. I'm currently unemployed, so I'm just, I've been doing a lot of this kind of stuff for many years. And I go, I volunteer for events so I can go to the events and listen to all the speakers and get all the cutting edge stuff.
All right,
And you're in Irvine?
To connect with people. Obviously, there's a lot of interesting people in the room, and I'm glad to make those connections.
All right, that's good. I'm glad you're here.
I grew up in England, had an American passport, I moved to America. I got to work with a lot of these like integrated doctors. So I was like, okay, I've got this like kind of doctors that I could help with, but I was also just like a single guy. And I guess I was taking the chance that if I got hit by a car, I'd be liable for it, right? And I took that chance. I kind of had a backup plan that if I got cancer, I could like fly back to England and sort of gouge the NHS. But none of you guys had that opportunity. So that was a little unique like that. But then 2013 rolled around, I had a child. And now it was like, basically, you know, irresponsible. My mother-in-law would have gone nuts if I didn't have health insurance. But I was looking around and I didn't see anything that, you know, looked like the values that I had. And I started to look further afield. And that's when I found out about this thing called a Christian health cost sharing ministry. Has anyone heard of that?
It's managed.
Hands up if you didn't, okay. So I joined this thing called Liberty Health Share. And let me just tell you this, that in 2010, there were 160,000 Americans that were part of these groups, Medishare, Samaritans, Liberty Health Share, there were five of them. And And then in 2010, something crazy happened where the ACA started, the Affordable Care Act. And in that moment, they were given an exemption to the Obamacare mandate. So you didn't have to have health insurance if you're one of their members. And it grew exponentially. Like, it grew to the fact that now a million Americans, as of now, use the Christian health cost-sharing ministries. And it's great because, as to give you an example, instead of paying $1,500 a month, which is like the least that I could have paid under any ACA, my wife's a childbearing age, I have a daughter, that's what it would cost for me with a huge deductible, I'd be paying $449 a month. So I'd be saving $1,000 a month over what I would have been spending, you know, on health insurance, and I could use that for all the weird medicine that I want, right? I can use that for, do that, and I do. And so I thought to myself, I've been thinking for a long time, and a couple of years ago, we partnered with one of the Christian ministries, and we helped to make a product, and people signed up for it, it was great, but it was never really under our control. And I just realized that as long as it was just a Christian thing, right, that it was just sort of a subsection of the rule, the idea of medical cost sharing could never really hit the number of people that it needs to hit in order to transform healthcare, which I think it has the potential to be. And so I thought to myself, you know, with our ability to reverse chronic disease, you know, surely the functional medicine community is the best group to start their own health cost sharing community. And I said to myself, if there was ever a chance to start my own alternative to health insurance that was built on health cost sharing as the model, because it built on community, we should do it. And that's really what we're talking about. We're talking about this sort of central part between these three. I love a good Venn diagram. But like community, we said at the beginning, right, the most powerful force in these Christian ministries, it's built on community. It's built around people taking care of each other. It's also built on the cash economy, right? Friends don't let friends pay retail for medicine. These guys are incredible at getting the prices down and they don't pay the highest rate. And if you throw in a little bit of reversing disease, right, reducing the cost in the long time, you have a very, very enticing proposition. And so I'm excited to share tonight, I've shared with some of you here already, but later this year, we're going to be launching the new health community, which is going to be the first non-denominational medical cost sharing program in America. And we're going to put these types of practitioners that you're seeing tonight at the front of medicine, not right at the end for Annie, where she's gone through all of her other doctors and eventually ended up with Felice, first at the front. The lifestyle and all those things there. So this is super exciting, is what we're going to be doing. And this is what it's going to look like. You know, member is going to be in the middle. You have your community support. You have a doctor available for you 24/7, so like Teladoc. Sometimes you need a prescription at 2 a.m. It's not as many times as you think it is, but sometimes you need that, so we have that. The functional medicine trained health coach, someone who can help you implement the healthy behaviors, right, who can help you to sleep better, eat better, relax, and to find community connection included with what you're doing, and a billing concierge. Never again will you have to be on the phone with Aetna trying to work out why they haven't paid, what you have to do, and organizing all that stuff. So is there anyone in this room that feels like being in the middle of this community is going to be better than what you've got before? Awesome. Thank you. So the timing is, the point of this tour is really to, you know, get the provider side, you start to seed the community, and we're going to hear throughout tonight of different ways that we can all get involved to bring this to community. So if you are interested in finding out more and staying in the loop, you can text individual to 38470. Individual to 38470 will keep you in the loop, and when it's ready to drop and for open enrollment a bit later this year, we'll be in touch there. All right, so let's kick on with the show. So how would we build the new health system if we knew the root causes of health conditions? You heard Felice there. She had a way of understanding what was the root cause in Annie's health. And ultimately, we're really excited to be able to bring to you a company that is involved in getting to the root cause of chronic health conditions. Please welcome to the stage the founder of Precision Analytical, the Dutch Test, Mark Newman.
Thank you, James. It's great to be here. Already had some great conversations with a lot of you. There are a lot of really sharp functional medicine doctors in the crowd. So this is what we're going to talk about for a little bit, but getting to the root cause of disease on the hormone side. I know a lot of you guys are wrestling with gut issues and things like that. Hormones are a big player in a lot of that. And so I want to walk through a little bit of our journey there. I spent a number of years working for labs doing 24-hour urine testing, blood testing, saliva testing, and just getting frustrated dealing with patients like Ann, because I've got to do a saliva test to get this information and a urine test to get these metabolites. And so we wanted to create a model of testing where we could kind of bring all of this together, where we're looking at our hormones, and this is probably hard to read from down there, but where we can look at that cortisol pattern to see the HPA axis, but also the androgens and the estrogen metabolites as they play into things like PCOS. And then once we built that model and started presenting it to the functional medicine community, we really got a lot of good traction because it just resonated so well with what limitations there were. So cue music round two. So, ta-da! So what we did to that then is as we grew, is just invested back in the test itself to add some other pieces of that. So we added an oxidative stress marker, we added a B6 and a B12 and a glutathione marker, because those play into that. And so what I want to do is just kind of go through how, as a functional medicine provider, you would use this type of a tool to get at the heart of an issue that's going on with a patient. And the reason we would do that is because we see a lot of people similar to the patient that Dr. Griff was talking about, that have these issues of fatigue and depression and anxiety and insomnia, and they're losing their scalp hair and maybe having hot flashes. This is kind of your typical like perimenopausal woman that's going to come into you and say, hey, what's going on? And the limitation of the traditional approach is that we just say, hey, you know, which tools do we have to eliminate these symptoms? So we might look at this list and say, well, you know, you've been self-medicating for fatigue with some caffeine. Maybe we throw a little bit of Prozac at you for your depression, and maybe some sleep meds. As she mentioned, spironolactone, maybe to deal with some of the potentially androgenic components of that, and maybe some HRT or something else to deal with the hot flashes. So you end up on this list of medications meant to sort of mask these symptoms, and maybe on some fronts you feel better for a little bit. But what functional medicine wants to do is say, hey, well, what are the root causes of these symptoms, right? If we can really get to what's driving these things, then maybe we can have some lasting change and become a little bit healthier long term. So then you get to this point of whether you want to guess or whether you want to test. And quite frankly, as a lab guy, it's always good for business if people are testing. But to be honest, a really intelligent functional medicine provider, like, I would put myself in the hands of that with some good symptoms and guessing over a traditional approach. But as we apply laboratory testing to that, we can get even a little bit more precise about what's going on, because what we find is with a lot of these things, there's a lot of overlap, right? I can be fatigued as a guy because my testosterone's low, or maybe because my cortisol's low. Maybe there's a thyroid issue. And of course, we want to get any of the lifestyle components that are playing into that addressed, or we're never really going to have lasting change, right? But that's where the lab testing can really come in to say, you know, if you're losing your scalp hair and it's an androgen issue or a thyroid issue, it really matters which one of those, you know, it may be before we reach for treatment. So let me just go through just two examples of where we would kind of see this in play. But if we're talking about, let's say, like emotional disturbances and things that might play into that, one of the things might be estrogen. If I've got too much estrogen, that might be an issue. And what I want to know about estrogen, with this particular patient we're going to look at, I want to ask myself, well, gee, is she making too much? Is she not making enough? Maybe she doesn't have enough progesterone to balance that. Or maybe she's got an issue with her metabolism. So let me show you how a functional medicine provider might address something like this with something like the Dutch test. So this is a piece of our estrogen report, right? So we're looking at your main estrogen, estradiol. This is a little hard to see on here, but you can see this is sort of your low limit, and this is your high limit. It sort of reads like a speedometer. So she's high, right? She's high for estradiol. Now, I can see that in a blood test. I can see that in a saliva test, or I can see it here in a urine test. What we add in on the urine test is you can see a lot of these estrogens are high. The one that's on the lower side is this 2-hydroxyestrogen, right? So this door is sort of closed, right? I've got this drain to get rid of my estrogen, and it's a little bit clogged. So as a functional medicine provider, you know that the key to opening up this pathway, or one of them, can be DIM, which is one of the reasons that cruciferous vegetables are good for you, right? DIM is a metabolite of something that's in cruciferous vegetables, and it opens up that pathway. So this was actually a friend of mine who was having some emotional trouble. She looked to be a little estrogen dominant, and we were able to get a little bit more precise with her, and look at how well balanced she is after just giving her something that targeted that, right? So we were able to open up that door, pull these estrogens down, and without some sort of like really significant intervention, we were able to give her more hormone balance by just looking at more precisely what's going on specifically for you and what can we do to counteract that. Cortisol is another one which we deal with a lot, right? People with adrenal issues, maybe they're fatigued. On the other side of it, maybe they've got some depression, right? So what do we want to know about cortisol? This was the main reason I developed the Dutch test, is to get a fuller picture of cortisol. Maybe you're making too much, maybe you're not making enough, maybe the up and down pattern that you're supposed to have is a little bit dysfunctional, or maybe you have a problem metabolizing your cortisol. All of these variables could be at play, and we can see all of them with the testing that we're doing. So this actually looks a lot like a lot of you. When we test doctors and they test themselves, we often see this great big jump in the morning because you have stressful practices, right? And that's a natural response to that, which says, hey, either one of two things. One, you have too much stress and you might want to address that lifestyle, or you don't have too much stress and this is an exaggerated response, right? So when you have a normal stress, this patient is really going crazy in terms of cortisol, which is going to cause some problems, right? If we're trying to get to the root cause of what's going on, cortisol is going to wreak some havoc, right? Now, we can see this up and down pattern in urine. In this case, we're looking at our Dutch plus, so it's saliva. So we're looking at it at waking. 30 minutes later, it's a little high. It's supposed to come back down, but it keeps going up, right? So that's a pretty significant issue. Then we can look at the metabolites. And if the patient looks like this, we say, look, we've confirmed that, yeah, she's making a lot of cortisol. But as we're looking for root cause analysis, if we see the patient that looks like this, we say, look, your cortisol's high, but your metabolites are low, then that's an indication that she's not metabolizing that cortisol very well, which we see a lot in people with low thyroid, because thyroid affects your ability to get rid of that cortisol. So then we get all these problems associated with cortisol, right? So most of you know there's an association. If you're making too much cortisol, you're more prone to depression, right? Well, how does that, you're also more prone to diabetes. Let me show you how that works, a little biochemistry, okay? So tryptophan is heading down this pathway to make NAD, right? You need a certain amount of B6 in order to do that. That pathway won't run unless you have a lot of B6, and cortisol pushes it further down this pathway. So what happens is if you're stressed, estrogen also pushes this pathway, so birth control patients look like this a lot. You push it this way, and you induce a B6 deficiency. So if you don't add enough, it makes something you can't really read on this screen, xanthuronic acid. So that's something we measure in the Dutch test. Why? Because it's a B6 marker, so that adds into the picture, but it also is something that's not very good for you because it complexes with insulin. So if you feed rats xanthuronic acid, they get diabetes because it actually reduces your insulin sensitivity. So now you start to see this connection of possibly a thyroid issue is affecting your cortisol. Too much cortisol pushes this in this direction, which induces a B6 deficiency, and now we've got this whole big issue, which also leaves not enough tryptophan for serotonin, right? So we've got a serotonin metabolite marker on the test as well, and you start to see this whole interconnectedness, serotonin, depression, right down here, we see this sort of diabetic sort of thing coming, all because of having our hormones out of whack. And that's the point of what we're doing, is trying to get as much of the information as we can on the hormones and things associated with them so that we can get to the heart of the problem. So with the Dutch test, we're looking at estrogen, androgens, DHEA, cortisol, all of this stuff and related metabolites. And what, you know, traditionally, if you're a functional medicine provider, you're usually using maybe serum testing, right, which has some of these things, and saliva testing, which has some of these things, right? So typically what people would start with is say, well, We get our basic hormones out of serum, the testosterone metabolism, which is really helpful for the PCOS patient, vitamin deficiencies, a little pricey in serum. So we start there. We'll add a salivary free cortisol, right? And now we're starting to get into that, you know, $300 range. And then we might want to add some estrogen metabolites and maybe an organic acid panel to look at some of these vitamin deficiencies and things like that. So that's the reason we built this tool for functional medicine providers. So that for $250, you can have an easy test and get a lot of this information to start digging and asking the question why, right? Why are you depressed? High cortisol. Why do you have high cortisol? Maybe it's a thyroid issue. We're going to dig into these issues and try to find that root cause analysis. And using comprehensive testing like that on the hormone side of things helps us to do that, to get to the root cause so you can find better solutions for your patients so they can be Annie again instead of Ann, and then they think you're brilliant providers, which you are, and you can help more and more people. So we're happy to do our part of it, which is the hormone side of it, and we're super happy to be along for the ride with James. So thanks for your time.
Thank you. So hopefully what you see there is why this is so congruent, right, with the New Vision Tour. Not only are we getting to the root cause of like a range of chronic conditions that are clearly reversible, right, you can see that it's, you know, that these cases, if left unmet, go towards depression medication, metformin, insulin, all those kind of things, and then can be dealt with unbelievably elegantly. And more to the point, you know, it's not skimming the insurance company for thousands and thousands of dollars only to get less money back. You know, it's a clear, easy price test. You can pay directly, or insurance pays. It's built for a health cost sharing community. Because 86% of health costs arise from lifestyle driven chronic disease. So, you can see, like when people think about healthcare costs, they think about getting hit by an ambulance and having to be taken to the hospital. But the truth is, the majority of the cost is residing in the ongoing use of chronic disease medication. And so if you can bring the kind of care that we're talking about here to the front of medicine rather than the back, we can start to make a dent in this. All right, so that was chapter four. We're gonna get that music. Guess what music's coming up next. Okay, so if you're a doctor or practitioner and you'd like to get paid cash to see members of our community, text DOCTOR to 38470. You know, that's part of the reason for this tour is to get the providers ready. Doctors, MD, DO, nurse practitioner, naturopathic doctor, if you're licensed to practice medicine and you are doing integrative functional medicine, we'd love to hear from you. Obviously, the demand and how many patients we're gonna send to you is gonna be a function of how many people that we get into this community later. But if you're here, obviously text that and we can get into it. All right, chapter five, how would we do medicine? How would we build the new system if we knew someone who could hold us accountable? So I'm just gonna go into boring maths teacher guy again for a moment, but this is a very simple equation. I wanna talk about value in healthcare, right? Value in healthcare is super important because everyone's looking, we're moving to value-based care, trying to get value out of healthcare. And ultimately what value is, if you sort of, there's many different ways of looking at it, there's all kinds of ways of assessing value, but it's really, what are the outcomes and what is the cost? One of the things in the first era of functional medicine that we saw was that because it was a new thing and doctors were just working out as they went along, they ended up having, the doctors were doing two things simultaneously. They're doing the root cause resolution diagnostics that you just saw, and they're also doing helping people do the healthy behaviors. The problem with that model is that the doctor is way overpriced to do this side, right? Because a health coach can essentially help people to execute on behavior change. There are all kinds of other providers that cost a lot less. Now, if the cost is less, and the outcome is the same, excuse me, the value is more, right? That's just the maths equation. So what we've seen and what we're doing up until now with New Health is trying to find what is the best way to get lifestyle transformation at the minimum possible cost, using content, using community, and using coaching. Because the differential in price means that you can get significantly better value with the same and better outcomes too. Excuse me. All right, so one of the other partners, FullScript. Anyone use FullScript here? Amazing. So FullScript just partnered with Natural Partners, so they're now going to be a dominant force in the industry. They've been great supporters for us for a while. If you go to newhealth.com/FullScript, you can set up an account. The reason I put it in this chapter is because reminding patients to do what they need to do can either be done by the practice or it can be done by technology in this case. And so they have some great adherence technology that helps to remind patients or users how to do it. So if you are a health coach and you're interested in having a job, you can write health coach to 38470. And just know that we've had 2,000 health coaches already who've said they're in, so I can't promise it'll be anything tomorrow, but it's exciting nonetheless. All right, chapter 6. How will we build healthcare if we knew all chronic disease starts in the gut? Really excited to welcome our next speaker. He's the Chief Science Officer of Megascopore Probiotic. My journey to get here is that I was a sales rep for a while. I was selling, for 7 years, I was selling to doctors, and that's how I learned about this whole industry. And our best-selling product back then was a spore-based probiotic, and I know that it works. I know that people use it. So please welcome to the stage, Kieran Krishan.
This feels special. So I've done like 20, 25 talks this year already. First time I've had intro music, so this is definitely a special occasion. Thank you, James, for having me. Thank you for the New Health Group for setting this up. I am very excited to talk to you guys about this, but if any of you had met me 6 years ago and said, you're gonna be building a probiotic company and doing probiotic products, I would have told you you're totally crazy, right? Because my career in this industry is spent on the research side. So I'm a microbiologist, I had a clinical research organization, I have an ingredient company that develops ingredient technologies, and that's what I was doing for a long time. I was helping companies build products, I was helping them do clinical trials, I was studying ingredients and so on. Then one fine day about 10 years ago, a large multinational company came to us, my research group, and wanted us to study probiotics for them, wanted us to look at what was on the market, this idea of let's get 19 strains in a product or 25 strains, or we need 200 billion and this stuff is refrigerated, this stuff is not. They wanted us to figure out what of all of that made sense, right? What was the right approach to probiotics? And if none of the approaches currently were the best approaches, what would be the best approach to probiotics? So we took and embarked on that journey for about 6 years. So we studied the market, and we started with, I was that annoying guy, I'd go to health food stores and I'd go, what are your best probiotics? And then the clerks would always say, well, you gotta go to the refrigerator. That's the best stuff, right? They're refrigerated, they're live cultures. And I go, well, why are they in the refrigerator? They said, well, you gotta keep them alive. If they're live cultures, they're gonna be very effective. And I said, okay, so if you left them in the room at the shelf or the room temperature, they would die. Yes, that's why we keep them refrigerated. And we take them home, put them in the refrigerator. I said, okay, so it can't sit at 70 degrees at room temperature. What about 98.6 degrees in the body and a pH of 1? Right, the stomach acid, as a microbiologist, I know is something we call a gastric barrier, because one of its jobs is to kill a lot of bacteria that enter your system. So it just started to not make sense to me. And when we start digging into it a little bit more, we found out that a lot of what is going on in the probiotic space didn't really measure up in terms of the scientific rationale behind it. And we felt that that was a significant issue, because as you guys all know, the gut holds the root cause to many chronic illnesses, right? But it's also the root or the route to health. And so we saw that probiotics really were not being utilized in the way they should be. And in our determination from the research that we did, we found a significant number of strains and capabilities of certain bacteria that could really afford significant impact on chronic illness. So that's how we focus. And so that was why we were compelled to kind of create a product, start doing research, bring it out there, because we want to give you guys tools to be able to affect the lives of your patients in a real positive way. So one of the first things that we started studying was, if we have a real probiotic, we have one that can go in and make a significant change in the gut, right? What is the most important function that that probiotic should play if we're looking at stemming or curbing chronic illness to some degree, right? A lot of the probiotic studies are on gas and bloating and irregularity, and those are important things. I don't want to say that they're not, but we wanted to look at what would be the most important job of a probiotic in the gut, and that is really to protect its host from this, right? Eating food. Eating food is like the most toxic thing you guys do, we all do, every single day. And this is true for even health foods. Now, the worse the food is, the more processed, the more caloric it is, the more the processed fat content, it gets worse. But even eating healthy food has a metabolic endotoxic response, right? So that process of eating and digesting food runs havoc within your microbiome and messes up your mucosa. And if you have a dysbiotic flora, you don't have the right bacteria to protect you against something we call metabolic endotoxemia. So what is metabolic endotoxemia? And so these next couple slides are kind of busy, but in interest of time, I'll put it all up and then I'll just explain what it is, right? So metabolic endotoxemia is basically this. It's basically an endotoxic response to metabolism, so to the process of eating food. And it's called an endotoxin because it's a toxin that exists within the gut, within the body itself. It's an endogenous toxin. So what the toxin is, it's LPS, lipopolysaccharide. Right, there are other bacterial and viral toxins that are significant as well, but we focused on LPS to begin with because there's a lot of other data on LPS as well showing that it's a major driver of chronic illness. So LPS is a part of gram-negative bacteria cell membranes. Now, the bacteria use this in various ways for communication. They use it as a binding tool. They use it as a way of communicating with our immune system in the gut itself. And when it's in the bacteria, there's no problem with it. And the vast majority of bacteria that live in your gut contain LPS, the good guys and the bad guys. So LPS is always going to be within your system, right? And so in order for us to prevent LPS endotoxemia, we have to make sure that LPS, when it's released, when the bacteria dies, isn't allowed to migrate through the mucosa and through the intestinal lining. And when it goes through the intestinal lining, it gets into the blood system. When it gets into the blood system, what it does is it causes a chronic innate immune response, which is subclinical, but you can measure it with the right lab test. But it's caused by the increase in endotoxins after a meal, right? So once the endotoxins get in, this is basically what they do to activate the immune system. But let me just explain it. So the LPS travels through the mucosa, travels through the intestinal lining, gets into the circulatory system. Once it's in the circulatory system, it's bound by something called LBP, which is LPS binding protein. That LBP carries the LPS to your innate immune cells called macrophages and dendritic cells, right? To present it essentially to these antigen-presenting cells themselves. Now, these guys that have toll-like receptors and CD14 on their systems, they will bind this LPS-LBP complex. And when they see this LPS-LBP complex, they think that the body is undergoing an invasion. And because of that, they express something called NF-kappa-B, and as a result, you get this huge array of things like interleukin-1 beta, interleukin-6, MCP-1, all of these inflammatory markers go through the roof. Now, this system has been very well studied for 5, 6, 7 decades in the context of sepsis. It's the exact same thing that happens in sepsis and bacteremia. So sepsis and bacteremia, they have studied the CD14 activation through microbial LPS. But this is also happening every time you eat food. So imagine every time you eat food, your body's going through a mini sepsis, right? The university that we did the study with, they previously did a study where they showed that it takes the body almost 2 weeks to recover from a single meal in terms of the inflammation that the meal causes and the damage. Now, this inflammation can be systemic. It can be localized to your brain, it can be localized to your knees, to your elbows, to all different places, because LPS is extremely viable within the body. It gets in and it can get into all kinds of tissues. So let me show you some of those. These are some of the clinical manifestations. Everything within the realm of metabolic syndrome has an LPS component to it. In fact, the American Diabetic Association is publishing more studies on metabolic endotoxemia with LPS than any other research institute, because they're showing that LPS endotoxemia, that's a moving of LPS from the gut lumen into the circulatory system, is a major driver of heart disease, hypertension, and then of course diabetes as well. It's the clinical onset of diabetes, and LPS can cause diabetes in two ways. It can cause hypothalamic insulin resistance before there's any metabolic change, and then it can get at the pancreas as well. So it does it in a two-pronged approach, right? So everything in here has some component of LPS endotoxemia in there. And again, it's happening every time we eat food. This is just a table of all the various diseases that I've found that have been well published that are associated with high degrees of LPS migrating from the gut into the circulatory system. Things like chronic constipation, mood and appetite disorders, because LPS can get in the brain and affect serotonin function, dopamine function. So that means, of course, anxiety, depression, cognitive decline in the case of LPS getting in and causing inflammation right at the blood-brain barrier. Loss of memory and recall, because it can get into areas like the hippocampus and the amygdala. This is a really interesting one, hypogonadism in the case of low testosterone in men. So high levels of LPS that chronically moves into your circulatory system, activates your immune system nonstop. That actually shuts down testosterone production. It's something called the Gelding theory, something you can read about. Autoimmunity, it's a major driver of autoimmunity, anxiety, anorexia, and so on. Of course, in the last, I think it was 18 months, two or three papers have been published showing that it's the primary driver of Alzheimer's and Parkinson's as well. Right, so LPS gets into the brain, starts the immune activation that starts the process of beta plaquing and so on that causes Alzheimer's. Same thing in Parkinson's, it does that in the central nervous system. So it's a major, major driver. It's in our gut all the time. So our question is, can we stop LPS from migrating from the lumen to the intestines, through the intestines into the circulatory system after a meal? And we wanted to use a challenge meal, so we used a fast food meal. This is a study we published in August of last year in the World Journal of Gastrointestinal Pathophysiology. We did a study with the University of North Texas. We're doing another version of the study. But the way we did the study is we took 100 healthy college students. These are healthy normals, no obesity, no Frank disease, no conditions to be worried about. And we screened them for this LPS endotoxemia response to food. So basically what we did is we took 100 of them, they came in fasting, we would take their blood levels of LPS and all the cytokines associated with it, and then we would give them a fast food meal, and then we would measure the blood levels again at 3 and 5 hours after the meal. If they saw a 6-7 fold increase of LPS, we knew they had severe endotoxemia, severe leaky gut, and we enrolled them into the study. When they were in the study, we gave them either the probiotic for 30 days or placebo for 30 days, and that's it. So these are college students, right? So they're not doing anything good for themselves in 30 days. So we were a little worried. We're like, I don't know if this probiotic is going to be enough to impact the gut in that amount of time to actually protect them from this endotoxemia. But as it turns out, this is what it looks like on the pilot study. So this is the baseline, the blue, and then the red was 30 days after probiotics. We almost completely blunted this endotoxic response, which is what you see. So this is time zero when we measure it in fasted state, and we give them a meal, and this is 5 hours after the amount of LPS. So the red bar is after the probiotic. And so we did a larger version of the study, and we saw in the spore treatment group an average of 45% reduction in the amount of endotoxemia after taking the probiotic for 30 days. Now what was scary was that in the non-treated group, in the placebo group, we saw a 32% increase. So the endotoxemia is getting worse. So the difference here is over 60% just in 30 days without all of the other wonderful things you would do with lifestyle modification, diet, and so on. And the beneficial thing is all of the other markers that indicate significant reduction in chronic inflammation in the body also went down. Things like triglycerides, for example, if you look at the blue, is in the treatment group, significant drop in liver fat in triglycerides in that 30 days. Whereas there was no drop at all in the placebo group. And then we looked at, the colors are a little skewed, but this is something called a heat map. So all of these things with the light colors show a reduction over 30 days. So all of those interleukin cytokines, like interleukin 1 beta, interleukin 6, interleukin 12, everything above that line was significantly reduced in just 30 days. Interleukin 1 beta is the number one target right now for cardiovascular drugs, because studies show that interleukin 1 beta is a major driver of plaquing in the arteries. So most pharma companies are looking at interleukin 1 beta antagonists to to shut off that system, which is, of course, the normal allopathic approach. But we can reduce it significantly with just a probiotic in 30 days, right? And something that's changing your microbiome. Everything down here trended towards a reduction, but the size of the group was not big enough to be significant. So at the end of the day, what we're seeing here is on the right-hand side is a patient or a subject, and this is a healthy normal that is getting more and more inflamed on a regular basis, because every time they eat a meal, it actually takes their body 2 weeks to recover from the meal, but they are eating three times a day. So they're never recovering from it. And then this same people, even though at this age they're 22, 23 years old, but this is setting up the pathology for the diseases that they're gonna come in and help have you try to help them with, right? So if we can stop this inflammation, this chronic inflammation, which is a major driver of the conditions, it can really dramatically help the results that you get with your patients and clients, because without stopping this flow of LPS, you're basically taking one step forward, two steps back, right? Because the gut continues to drive this condition. So we've got 9 other clinical trials going on right now. We're investing heavily in studies, and at the end of the day, we want to give you guys really, really potent, amazing tools to be able to affect lives in a positive way. And again, I didn't think I was going to be doing this, but I'm so glad that I am, and I'm very glad for people like James that give us a forum to talk to you guys about it. So thank you so much.
Right, it's, you know, one of the reasons, again, we get to just curate for so long at the Functional Forum. We didn't take any supplemental lab sponsors because we wanted to make sure that the community came first. And so we got to partner with the companies that we like along the way. And, you know, as I said, this is, you know, pretty powerful stuff. All right, so next chapter. Where are we going here? All right, so... yeah, so this chapter is sponsored by the Evolution of Medicine. Some of you guys have read the book outside I wrote. The goal of the Evolution of Medicine is to help doctors and practitioners make the journey to functional medicine. The first thing we had to do is to get way more practitioners ready to go. So if you're interested, you can check that out outside. You know, what we've really found, there's a lot of people. Is there some health coaches in the room here? Okay, yeah, people who are health coaches, right? So, you know, the cool thing about being a health coach is, like, you have an amazing experience with functional medicine, you want to get involved in the industry, and so, you know, there's a short way to be able to sort of get involved and get certified so that you can go out and help people. And it's been awesome to see this new energy come into the industry. But what we see is that, like, there's a lot of people that go through this journey and then they're not sure that they want to be a health coach. Do they actually want to commit to having a career where they have to sit opposite from people and essentially play kind of a clinician role? And so we've created a new program called the Practice Marketing Implementer for someone who's passionate about functional medicine, doesn't want to be a clinician, but does want to get out of their boring day job and do something fun and exciting. So if that's you, check out goegomed.com/PMI. We're going to teach you how to run the marketing for a functional medicine practice. And then there are a ton of doctors who will be ready to hire you straight afterwards. And I know all of them. So it's good. So this is all the stuff that you're going to learn. We just start. It actually starts tomorrow night. It's the first time that we're running the course. We've got a really good group of people coming in just to try and make it easy for everyone who wants to be part of this revolution to participate. All right, so the next chapter is how we do medicine if new ingredients matter. Ultimately, you've heard those ingredients, whether it be the ingredients in the food, whether it be the ingredients in, you know, in the life and what you're up to. One of the sponsors for this tour is Genexa. So one of the things that I'm excited about with Genexa is that they are the first organic, non-GMO pharmaceutical company. You know, most people out there, until 2016, you didn't have to put what was inside, there was no label claims or labels for pharma. You didn't have to put what the ingredients were in. And when in 2016, when that was mandated, it wasn't a pretty, right? The stuff that was going in there, the dyes, the fillers, the glues, all the things that were put in with the like tiny amount of active ingredient. So you can check them out outside, Genexa. They're a cool company. They start with homeopathics, but now they've got, you know, tons without talc, and they've just got the first clean pharmaceutical. It's a cool company, and we're proud to have them on the team. All right, we're moving along because we are running a little bit late here, but, well, UC Irvine might be the center of the integrated medicine universe. right? So let's have a chat for that. So, you know, recently some significant donors gave an incredible amount of money to the UC Irvine Center, and we're really excited to see in the next 10, 20 years what's going to happen in this part of the world. So I'm excited to have our next speaker. She's the head of functional medicine at the UC Irvine Center. She's also a naturopathic doctor. Please welcome Dr. Firuz Demiri.
I'm Canadian. If he was here, I would totally guess. Anyways, I'm so honored to be here, Dr. Gersh, Dutch, all these labs and things that I use in practice. But the reason I'm here today was because I was sick. I was very sick. I was pre-med going into medical school, and I had three chronic disease conditions at the age of 21. I was overweight. I probably looked older than I look now, and I was going into my doctor's. Month after month, I was on 5 prescription meds, and I actually thought that was good because I was going to be a doctor, and here I was going to doctors and I was on medications. I actually thought that was the right thing to do because growing up in Iran, we were poor. And so my parents thought if they took me to get shots and to go visit the doctor and get meds, they were doing the right thing. That was healthy. Well, little did I know that a boyfriend at that time was looking at me and going, you know, you're really not healthy. You're getting all these migraines, and why don't you go see a naturopathic doctor? And I said, a natural what? And that's what changed my life. So the reason I want to talk to you guys about my story is because she helped me get to know myself. And the reason why she did that was nothing fancy. She just spent time with me. She spent almost 2 hours on an initial visit and asked the questions my kids ask. Just basic questions. Why? Everything I would say, she would say, oh, I wonder why you do that. I wonder why you do that. I wonder why you want to become a doctor. And I said, because I'm caring. I care for people. And she said, okay, why is that? But basically, it got down to me realizing my core beliefs. And one of them was that I felt I wasn't good enough. And the underlying causes often for being the Persians here, we either are doctors or engineers. So I kind of had no choice. I had to pick one or the other to please my father. Fast forward 20 years, I have a patient who comes in. She's 45, female, very big person here in Orange County. I obviously can't say her name, but she is CEO of a huge company, does really well for herself. She comes in, she's been to many integrative doctors here, and my director says that, you know, this person's really important. And, you know, no pressure, I'm so nervous. I have my residents that day who are going to see this person. And so the residents get to see her, and I'm the attending, and, you know, we've done it. This person has done every lab you can think of. She's been on Xanax for 20 years, now on Clonopin, high dose, which are benzodiazepines, which are pretty hard to get off of if you've been on them for a long time, especially at the dose that she was on. She has been to therapy for 7 years. She was overweight, and that's the reason why she actually came in. Her chief concern was weight. And the last thing on her list was anxiety. And so, you know, as functional medicine or naturopathic doctors do, we get the story. They present to me the case with her story. This is how she was born. She was breastfed. This is what she ate. She had a lot of sugar. These are the traumas in her life. They tell me the story. And often what we do is we go beyond the story. Okay, so who is this person with this diagnosis, with this story? The story is not enough. That ICD code often does more harm than good. And as a physician myself, I've probably done more harm than good by labeling people with this thing. And what I had to do after a lot of visits that I saw she was not getting better, she was on, already tried every anti-anxiety, herb, L-theanine, every genetic test, I mean, you name it. And for an anxious person to get more testing and be told that this is another thing you need to address is not a good thing. We're actually doing more harm. So I got to, you know, I said, you know, enough, guys, come on in. Let's go in with her and let's book 2 hours with this patient. What is that? Time. time is precious. That's why I'm so grateful to do what I do, is because I have time. I cannot imagine what kind of a doctor I would be if I didn't have that much time. I got to know her and I said, okay, so you have this label. And I knew right away from all the therapy she's had done, she was giving me all the answers that people give because they know what the right thing is to say. So I knew it's kind of like a nut. You have to crack to get inside the seed. And I said, okay, you're going to be challenging because there's a lot of resistance I'm feeling from you. You're very attached to this diagnosis. You're so attached to panic disorders. She's had a lot of panic disorders and anxiety that I need to go underneath that. And I said, what are you so anxious about? Let's pretend we're six. I have a six-year-old, so it helps. Let's pretend we're six and I don't know that word. I don't know, I'm not a doctor. How would you describe what you feel? And she said, I get scared. And I said, scared of what? And she said, that I'm gonna die. And I said, okay, so you're scared of death? And she said, well, yeah, I guess. And I said, okay, I'm thinking in my head, you've got all this therapy, you must know more of what this is about. And she said, yeah, I'm scared of dying. The smallest little thing makes me feel like I'm gonna die. And I said, okay. And so I go, what is it about death that scares you? So what? So you're gonna die. And I literally became a six-year-old, and I just was so intrigued to understand her. And I was not attached to treating her. I wasn't attached to getting rid of the anxiety. I actually wasn't attached to anything. I just wanted to know, how is your fear of death different than my father's fear of death? And I know we don't have a lot of time, but basically we got to this. She said, I just feel like I'm gonna run out of time. I feel like, you know, I have three kids, I run this big business, my husband's also famous and has his own business, and we don't get to spend a lot of time together. And I said, okay, so what is it about death again that you're afraid of? Do you think you're gonna get cancer? Like, this is what I'm thinking. And no, it really wasn't a fear of death. What do you guys think she was really afraid of? Exactly, so not having enough time is what? And so I said to her, I don't know, are you afraid of death or are you afraid of not living? And I know this sounds really simple, especially coming from a physician, but it really was that simple. This was 3 years ago and she has not had one panic attack. And now we have history of anxiety on her ICD codes. She's off Klonopin, which was not easy to do, but she is. And the moral of the story is that helping people get to know themselves, the core, the underneath layers, with time is what's missing right now in medicine. And if I had had health coaches at that time, I wouldn't have had to keep checking in and reminding her and helping her live her purpose. She's no longer, she sold the business and she's a salsa instructor because her passion was to dance. But again, none of this would have happened if I wasn't fortunate enough to collect insurance, which is very rare for what we do. And this needs to be available for everyone, not for patients who have money, not for patients who have insurance, but for every single person. We need to have time. And I'm so thankful for James for coming up with this brilliant idea, and thank you.
There's a lot of passion in this room, and there's so much talent in this part of the world of people who are doing the right thing, and I can't wait to see what happens at UC Irvine as a result of that, and the leadership from Dr. Demir and others. All right, so what puts us in a position to think that we could pull off this crazy thing, right? Is there, you know, it sounds unreasonable. I'm just a guy living in a bus and going from city to city to evangelize. So for the last little while, we at New Health, we've been working with employers to do functional medicine scale. The first question that I asked when I started the evolution of medicine was, what would we do if we knew we needed 100,000 functional medicine doctors? So we put all the content online for free, we built these meetup groups, and we started to make it easy for doctors to find out about functional medicine. You have to go to a conference, spend a ton of money, you don't even know what it is, let's just put it online for free. And we just happened to catch it at the right time and send a lot of doctors towards functional medicine. So the second question that we started to ask is, okay, if we knew that everyone needed functional medicine, how would we do it? Because there's a limited number of doctors, and that's when we started to think about the health coach side of things. So for the last year, we've been playing with this company called Benecop, And they are an insurance provider that provides insurance to companies through employers. And they saw the same thing, which is like in most insurance plans, you have your traditional insurance plan, you bolt on a bit of wellness. And this wellness could literally be anything, right? It could be, you know, it could be like diet soda. It could be, you know, it could be like a fair where they have someone come and, you know, wellness in companies is weird. My next guest could maybe talk into that a little bit. But they just thought, look, why not put integrated wellness into the whole insurance plan? The CEO went to a functional medicine doctor, reversed his chronic disease, and was like, what's this? How do we get it? And ultimately, that's what we've been setting up. So the way that we do it is this. We put people into three tiers. Now, we're using things here. What you would see is that this is green, this is yellow, and this is red. Right? Just imagine that that's what this is. So what we saw is we put these into three tiers because these people need the functional medicine doctor, right? Severe chronic. These people cost a lot now. They're going to cost even more down the road. These people need the functional medicine doctor, right? That's pretty clear. These guys are multiple medications, multiple issues, and some serious like polypharmacy, right? A lot of drugs going on. It's hard to know what's going on. These people don't really need that much at all. They just need to be kept on the path and doing the behaviors. This is the most important part. Tier two, people who are not quite severely chronically ill yet, but if you leave them to it, are going to end up in this category. But if you give them a little bit of input, we thought if we could just get them with a health coach, just starting to do the healthy behaviors, they could go back up into tier one. And that's what we've been doing. So I just kind of assumed that the world would look like this, right? A lot of healthy people at the top, a few mildly chronically ill, and some more seriously chronically ill people. So we started working with our first company, and were they, you know, a beauty company in OC, Los Angeles, with lots of fit and healthy people? No, we started at a completely other end of the spectrum, a car dealership in rural South Carolina. And this is actually what it ended up looking like. We had, out of 150 employees, one person fit the healthy criteria. 30 were in the chronically ill category, and everyone else was here. This is going to decide what happens to these people, whether they go down into tier three or whether they go back into tier one, will decide the financial future of everyone in this room and all their children. Because if we don't get this right and these people go down here, it will bankrupt every American, and it will bankrupt actually everyone on the planet, because chronic disease is the biggest problem on the planet. It's no longer just our problem. This is a priority. This is a national security priority. This is a fiduciary priority. And it just so happens that functional medicine and health coaching is really good at doing this. We're getting good at it. So that's why we've been doing this for a while. So if you know employers that are interested in saving money on healthcare, text employer to 38470. Part of the purpose of this tour was to kick out and meet employers. Last week I spoke at the Nutrition Business Journal Summit in front of 500 CEOs of all the supplement companies, because you think if any company's gonna get on board, it's gonna be the companies in the space. And it was super cool. We chat to a number of good companies. We chat with the Dairy Farmers Association of America. Not sure if they're going to be happy about the dairy-free diet, but generally it was really, really exciting. So, you know, we've worked with these employers up until now, and ultimately all we're talking about is taking this layer of care that we've developed, which is essentially the functional medicine trained health coach, and sticking that at the front of medicine, right? Trying to get people better and trying to get people off drugs and trying to get people to a point where they don't cost a lot. And if you have a magic source for reducing the cost of chronic disease, what should you do? You should start a cost-sharing community. That is definitely what you should do. All right, so. I'm gonna work this out my next sounds a little bit finicky here tonight. So, my next guest, the final guest, lives right around the corner. It's an absolute honor to have him here. He's a really great friend. He's been a mentor and a supporter of the Functional Forum. The only other event that we ever did in the OC, we did at his video studio, which is not far from here in Lake Forest. Many people know him as the Urban Monk. He's got a New York Times best-selling book, but he's also a doctor of oriental medicine, and he's here to share how would we build the new system if we all knew how to keep ourselves healthy. Please welcome Dr. Pedro Chodra.
I actually just came, I've been gone for about 2 months filming a series on microbiome. Came home, took the kids out of camp, and spending the week just hanging out. So I took them to see the Star Wars movie today. And there was a commercial, a Diet Coke commercial. Raise your hand if you've seen this in the theaters, right? Am I allowed to cuss? Literally, hey, yeah, you know, you can do this wellness thing, but it's so inconvenient. Like, what you should do is just say, fuck it, drink that. And it took me back to what got me into this mess, because I was seeing 30, 40 patients a day as an acupuncturist, and then I realized that I wasn't fixing things fast enough, so I scaled myself. I was seeing 70, 80 patients a day. How the hell can you do after losing his job, seeing 70, 80 patients a day? It wasn't working. So then I started a medical group, had 3 offices, 30 doctors. People started becoming cases, right? And I realized that I was in a model where the incentives were not aligned with wellness, right? And right around this time, there was a commercial on TV with Larry the Cable Guy. Standing in front of some hot dog stand, saying, you know, I used to get all sorts of stomach problems eating this crap, but now there's Prilosec, and I could keep eating this crap. And it was this moment in my career where I was like, whoa, we are losing this propaganda game. I'm on tour right now. I just came from Harvard, Johns Hopkins. I've just been all over the country talking to experts on the microbiome. It's fascinating. Anyone who's been kind of reading up on this stuff, it is going to revolutionize medicine. I think it already has. But the questions everyone wants to ask is like, okay, so just tell me which one to take me to, like, the store. Tell me which supplement I need to take, right? What's the probiotic out there that's going to fix this? And there's people, I actually know some people, I've yelled at them, in Malibu, who are taking fecal oral transplant pills. Because they heard it's good for them. So they would rather eat a fistful of shit than change their lifestyle. Right? And so, like, you know, as I'm in this inquiry, I'm like, oh my God. If we don't fix the lens through which we're looking, this pill for an ill or Crepsil for an ill model is not going to work. Right? And so let's look at these systems, right? These systems are designed, they're built on the inefficiencies, and they're built on chronic disease. So we can look at it and say, okay, well, it's just how it is, right? Or we take a stand and we do something about it. And the challenge I've seen out there, you know, I haven't seen patients in years now, but I've been around the block, right? I've done a lot of corporate wellness. I've done a lot of whatever I thought would stick to the wall and help, right? Who here is actively seeing patients? Okay, just need to know the room. And who here is within the model of insurance pay? Okay, less so. All right. It's a cabal, right? It's a trap. And I've gotten to the top of, you know, in Sacramento at least, in conversations with, you know, or wellness conversations. And it gets very mobby very fast. No one wants to fix healthcare if they're in that in that particular part of that street, right? It's super lucrative. So we're looking down the barrel of bankruptcy. We're looking down the barrel of a number of things that won't really bode well for the future. I got a couple of young kids. And I look down the barrel of the life that they are going to inherit. If, God willing, I do my job right and they stay healthy, then they do wonderfully and they become a doctor or engineer. I won't do that to them, right? Stops here. Then the burden of just carrying the children that are not is going to break. It's you can't win. You can't, like, so when I'm listening to this series that I'm recording, on the other side talking to these geniuses, my primary instinct is to run for the hills because everything causes cancer. Oh my God, it turns out these pesticides cause diabetes. I mean, just go down. We all know this stuff. We've heard this stuff. So the instinct is to run for the hills and at least take care of your own. It's too late for that. We have to stand and fight, right? We have to stand for what we believe in. We have to make those changes in our lives here and now. And so, yeah, I'm in Orange County, right? Because this is where the convenient airport and the fast internet and, you know, access to a lot of things happened for me, as much as I'd love to live in Montana. I also married a Persian girl, it's not happening. But then the question becomes, what can we do here? And when we hear crazy ideas, they're only crazy because they're not part of the status quo. Why can't we do what's being proposed here? It just takes momentum. So what is momentum? So much people sit in this room, right? Every good idea needs its early adopters to light the fire and carry it. So I'm very excited about the conversation that's happening here. And the conversation has to also be around education and just breaking this kind of crystalline matrix of a belief system that's driving us right off a cliff. So every single person here knows people that bought that crap, right? That live in that world that, you know, are getting capsules and pills thrown at them, and they're managing their disease. They're not fixing anything, right? And so it's one thing to preach, it's one thing to judge, it's another thing to lovingly educate, embrace, and put things in front of them. There's so much good media out there. There's so many of these gajillion summits, right? Like all these docuseries, there's all this stuff out there that's absolutely radically transforming lives because people are getting access to information. So the revolution will not be on TV, right? This information is not going to be, if you turn on TV, and I've been in a lot of hotel rooms this last couple months, every single ad, I mean, what, not every single ad, 30, 40% of them, pharma, right? So is NBC going to say something that's going to piss off 30, 40% of their business, their client base? They're not. So I turn to the internet. A lot of the doctors that we work with have turned to the internet. And this information is starting to shift, right? And it won't be on TV until that model starts to break. So my biggest ask of you guys is when you see something that rings true, if you just go, oh, that was interesting, and leave it at that, that information died with you, right? You have to share that information. When there's good news, it's about the people in this room. You are the early adopters. This is the Mayflower. That's the part that, like, people don't get when they're in a revolution, right? You're sitting in this room for a reason. So run with it. Run with it. And scream from the rooftops, because that's the most important thing. I had to leave medicine to get a megaphone and do what I do. And I miss it. I miss, you know, patient care and interaction and all that stuff. But I have to say that on the side of what I've been seeing and what I've learned, it is already happening. This is done. It's just a matter of time, and the velocity and the momentum will be carried by us. There's just millions more people that would suffer by you sitting on your hands right now, right? It's happened. This new model will happen, and it will make everyone go, huh, wow, we were dumb, right? we were really dumb. We all knew that didn't work. We just needed to step through. And so this is it, really. It's our chance to step through and be part of the future and the right side of history. And I see that happening in rooms like this. So I want to thank you all for coming out. And let's do this together.
Thank you. You know, I'm a theme of that. I mean, ultimately, Pedro's done such an incredible job in taking content to the masses on how to keep healthy. He got a few things outside of the merch booth. I mentioned this earlier to people, but, you know, we got to start with education at the lowest possible level. And this is my five-year-old daughter's favorite book, Buddy's in My Belly. If you've got a 2 to 10-year-old who needs to learn about the microbiome, great book, check this out. You know, many doctors, if you're a practitioner in here, have you ever given a patient a book and said, read this and do this and we'll speak next time? To give them all the content, because you can't say at that time, like Whole 30, other diet books, that kind of thing. This book, How to Make Disease Disappear, is the most comprehensive book that I've seen, easily read, easily written, where you can say to a patient, here's how to live a healthy lifestyle, go get them, and take the need for you to deliver the content off of your plate. You can get it outside, Dr. Rangan Chatterjee. If you're not sure about what your role is to play in this revolution, and you need a prompt to understand that, my wife, Rachel, give us a wave here. She's the driver of the bus, and many other things as well. She's made this incredible story card. You can go and get a card from the booth afterwards. I'm sure she'll tell you what it's all about. All right, so let's wrap up here. How would we do medicine differently if we knew we needed a new standard of care? What you've seen tonight, we can't go on with the current standard of care. We can't put this kind of healthcare at the bottom of healthcare, waiting for the wreckage to come down doing it. It has to go at the top. So if we knew we needed a new standard of care, well, luckily, I named the company New, so it works pretty well. It's called the New Standard of Care. And it adopts from functional medicine, adopts from community, adopts from healthy behaviors, it adopts from naturopathic medicine. So I just wanted to take you through. If you come and join this community, this is what you're signing up for. So first and foremost, it's patient-centered, right? If it's a patient-centered medical system, the patient has to participate, right? So by joining this, you're agreeing that you're going to participate, taking ownership of your health, data, and wellness goals. The second thing is we're going to do no harm. This is taken right from naturopathic medicine. We start with the least invasive, least costly, and most effective modalities first. Drugs and surgery are not those, right? We're going to start with the lowest and the cheapest and move up from there. This is called the naturopathic therapeutic order, and it's an idea whose time has come. The Lifestyle Foundation. Everyone is going to have the health coach to help you lead a healthy lifestyle and understand that. Then we're going to dive into some of the functional medicine stuff, thinking in systems. So not just thinking about particular organs, but thinking about how all the system works, identifying the root causes, just like Mark said up here. You know, getting a diagnosis of depression is not good enough. We're going to look under the surface and see what's causing it. And we're going to integrate modalities. So working with different types of practitioners based on the members' preferences and beliefs. We don't have time to get into the placebo effect, but this is placebo-maximized medicine. How do we maximize that service? Interaction, interactive ecosystem for data management, and community leadership. One of the most awesome things that we've seen so far is that the first consumers, the first users of New Health who have been going through the process, they want to end up being the health coaches. They want to help, they want to aid the exponential trajectory and move into it. And so that is where that, this is how we grow exponentially through turning the first users into the next endorsers. So what do you guys think about the new standard of care? Are you ready for something like that? Yeah. So the last question is, you know, Pedro spoke to this a little bit. How would we build medicine differently if we knew that we didn't have to ask permission to change the system? So many of the stories in healthcare that we're talking about is where, first of all, a patient goes to a doctor and that doctor gave them permission to do what they already knew was right. Right? So much in America and everywhere we go, it's about permission. It's about people thinking they have permission to do something. And what we don't have is permission to start our own health thing, right? We play within the system. But the truth is, just like Pedro said, this is the opportunity. This is a Harris poll recently came out. 7% of people trust their health insurance company, right? Trusting your health insurance company should be a high percentage of trust because it's really important, right? It's really an important part of this, but 7% of people trust it. That's lower than the president. That's lower than Congress, right? Congress is like notoriously low, and it's lower than that. This is our opportunity. Everyone hates their health insurance. If you could get, what about the people that don't know anything about functional medicine, but also hate their health insurance? That's a lot of people. What if we got those people involved, and then they just got the functional medicine, and they didn't maybe even know it was functional medicine. They just know they have someone who'll take the time to speak with them that is interested about helping them stay healthy. This is the opportunity. The reason when I want people to come interview, I want people to say, just like Pedro said, like, this is just the way that it should be, right? This is just the way that it should be. So the new health community, starting in September, we're gonna start early enrollment. We're gonna start to push people through and test the systems. The big moment happens on November 1st. On November 1st, in October, I don't know if you remember the last election, but in October, everyone gets that letter. And that letter says, hey, your health insurance premiums are going up by X percent next year, or you've been kicked out, right? That changed the last election, right? It was a big factor, and that's gonna start happening in October. And there's some things happening in the news that tell me that it's likely that this is gonna be an absolute mess this year, right? Where the numbers may go up even more than we've ever seen. And in Arizona last year, it went up by 114% in 1 year. So, come and join us. If you're tired of overpaying for insurance, text individual to 38470. We'll come up with you. I've been asked about this, the sticker that you're wearing. It kind of looks like a presidential campaign. I'm driving a bus around the country. But in November, there are elections, yes. But the one thing that we can all do, we can all vote. If you live in California and you vote in the presidential election, it's a little frustrating because you can't really have any sort of impact on that way. But every day, we vote with our dollars to what kind of services that we want. And the reason why I'm saying vote new is because we have an opportunity, and where we go from here is to communicate that this year there will be a new alternative to choose. And if we get enough people to vote for it, it will just happen. It doesn't need anyone's permission to do it. And that's the future that we're talking about. That's the future that I would like to, that our community can take on. So thank you for being, I know you've been very patient for being here tonight. Thank you to all the speakers as well. Thanks so much for being here. I'll stick around and ask any questions that you guys have about, you know, the health cost sharing community or otherwise. Thank you all for being here, and we'll see you again soon.